Welcome to our session today from the HPC Certification Forum for our little workshop toward a globally acknowledged and free HPC certification. So the session will be recorded. We will have some repeated talks from Monday, but we will shorten them slightly. So if you are interested in the full audited version, watch the videos maybe from Monday. So the workshop, we want to discuss opportunities in the roadmap and foster collaboration for this HPC certification. First, we'll get a short introduction, and then we have invited speakers to talk about 10 minutes each. Then we talk about the examination and certification, and we have a discussion time. Let me see, something is wrong with the screen, it seems, because you cannot see everything. It seems to work. Good. Yes. So if you have questions, please put them into the chat window. That's the easiest one. And we will answer them during the talk or after that, whenever it's more convenient for the speakers. So you can be very critical. That's the goal of such a workshop, because we want to make progress. Okay. So let's get started. We all know that we have challenges in HPC training, that users have not the right level of training, they have a diverse user background and goals. It's really hard for them to learn HPC skills. Data centers that kind of deliver teaching have difficulties to verify the skill of the users. Now, the HPC Certification Forum has a goal that is to standardize the HPC knowledge representation in a fine-grained fashion. It's like a big puzzle where we try to standardize individual puzzle pieces. And as a practitioner, you can then hopefully navigate and find out what competences are relevant in a quicker way. We also want to establish international certification for free, basically, and support an ecosystem around HPC competences. So the forum is the central authority for competence representation, certification, and the support, but we do not compete with competent providers. We try to link basically existing training material and training material offered by people, but we do not produce any content itself. Also, we do not prescribe a curriculum. That's the responsibility of centers or universities. It's really just a puzzle that we produce. So the forum is an international body that is independent from any organization. It's also not funded, but we try to associate projects with it as possible to support it, of course, and everyone is welcome to do so, by the way. We have a steering board that is elected. We have full members that have voting rights for this steering board. And typically, what distinguishes a full member from just a normal associate member is that they are contributing. So any kind of contributor will gain voting rights and can be elected to the steering board. And anyone is welcome to associate with the forum's activity, and any institution is as well. At some point, we put up this list on the webpage, which I think will raise that activity even further. If we collaborate with external organizations like HPC Education, but we also had chatted with the Gauss Alliance from Germany and with, for example, the EU. Yeah, so I talked about the responsibilities, the membership. So in the election, so I bring it up, the period is from June to June normally. This year we have a little bit distraction because of the coronavirus, of course. So we will delay it by a month, but also we have some change. We are now approaching the third year of this activity of the forum, and some people dropped out because of the responsibility. So if you are interested to contribute and you will be active, join our Slack channel and the election channel in particular, and then we may consider you for the steering board. As the steering board is rather big, there's a good chance that you will be considered. So please apply and support us. Okay, normally, so during this period of 1 year of activity, we we would have at ISE HPC, which is a European conference, we would have kind of a takeover from the new steering board from the old steering board. So we have governance rules splitting responsibility across the different roles in the steering board, but as we are pretty much very democratic at the moment, because every help is welcome, and mostly we resolve issues that arise by a short discussion. Okay, we have chairs and we have curators. We call it curators if they really look for this puzzle pieces and subset of the tree, as you will see in a minute. So we analyze our skills in a tree, and someone has to look for this tree. Good. So how do we organize ourselves? We have the web page, we have mailing lists, please subscribe to the mailing list. We have monthly public meetings on our Slack channel, to which we invite using the mailing list. We have this annual assembly. And everything we develop is available in the open on GitHub. And well, one exception is the examination questions for good reasons. Later will be addressed in our talk. So when we talk about HPC competences, what we mean in short is skills. We use this term a lot because it's shorter. A skill defines the background, objectives, and learning outcomes. We kind of organize those skills in a skill tree. So it's not just a 2D puzzle. We really try to make a tree representation for the users, but there can be links between those tree elements, between those individual subtrees. So we have six top level kind of topics, and then each of these points can be explored further and should go until you reach the leaf level, which is really fine grained. Here's a high level skill. In short, also it's on the leaf level. It's like Slurm workload manager. Here's shortened background information for the practitioners. We see an aim for this kind of skill, and we see a couple of learning outcomes. And these learning outcomes, they are basically such much that they are examinable. That's the goal. So teaching, when you do teaching in higher education, you have to train certain learning outcomes, and then you have to examine them to be sure that the people have really obtained those skills. So let me actually show myself, by the way. We did spend quite some time how to organize those competences. The granularity plays an important role. Basically, what we said is on the leaf node level of the tree, you can train such a skill in 1 to 4 hours lecture or workshop. So, and usually that means as a user, like when you think about this Slurm workload manager, for instance, if you work on a data center, if you're a practitioner on a data center that uses Slurm, this skill should really give you the basic level of competence to really use it. There shouldn't be advanced features where you say, oh, why do I learn this, right? It should be really condensed and focused with things that you say, yeah, I basically need 95% of all the things that I learned. And that way you can hopefully convince the users to participate. I didn't click on share video. Now it works, I hope. That way you can hopefully convince the users to actually take part in such a training. Okay. Yeah, I mentioned all those aspects. We kind of, as we are a community effort, we require the feedback of the HPC community to justify this kind of skill tree and the organizations and the approaches. So everyone is welcome to contribute, like I mentioned before. Okay, since testing an examination of an individual skill is tricky, as there is not too much material, and we basically bundle individual skills together to a certificate, which we found useful at the moment. Also, a key strategy is that we separate the definition of a skill, the certification itself, and the person that provides the training, which we call as a content provider. So the benefit is that you can think of like similar to a high school graduation. You have someone that defines you have to learn math. You should know addition, between numbers 1 to 10 with another number between 1 to 10. You should know this. And then someone else delivers the training material. And at the end, you can test that this person has the skills. Also, a key concept is that we say you can have different views to this puzzle of skills, so that you can gear it for individual roles like a tester, builder, or developer of certain software products. You can gear it towards the scientific domain like chemistry, whatever. And basically, you could have someone that says, if you want to use my software, please, you should have this skill. This skill and this skill and this skill. So we believe that's really effective to help people to know how they can contribute to software and how they can actually execute such a software on a particular data center. So we released a version of the skill tree, and we also have technical representations of the skill tree on the wiki and like supportive tools, like I mentioned, for example, JavaScript for visualization of the skill tree, where you can add, for instance, links and stuff. We have developed prototypes for the exam process and framework for the examination. Tree versioning, we looked into that a little bit. We designed a seal of endorsement that trainers can put on upfront on the training material, such that practitioners know, okay, this trains partially or completely, you know, this certain skills in the skill tree. Helpful, again, to navigate. And also we did some surveys to verify the skill tree, and this isn't done as this is an ongoing effort. Okay, the wiki for the skills looks in a nutshell like this. Again, you see basically the definition of the skill, the aims and the outcomes. Here is really a high level skill. By that I mean here one that is basically the tree on the top of the tree. So HPC knowledge is theoretical knowledge of HPC. Okay, how can you contribute to such a skill tree? We have this a web page with markdown version controlled in Git, and either you can use the wiki, you have to register to it, but then you can use it, or you can do pull requests if you have more changes to do by cloning this repository here. Happy also to see reviews and comments to it. We have a mind map version that is basically dealing with the structure of the skill tree and the benefit of this mind map that is synchronized with the skill tree. And of course, you can always contribute to the discussions on Slack, where here is the link when you click on the PDF. Okay, that was really much quicker compared to Monday, 15 minutes quicker. Okay, in short, by using the HPC certification forum and by developing this, we hope that we get a lot of benefits for HPC practitioners and data centers. In a nutshell, we want to see increased motivation to participate. We want to see that people can validate their knowledge, that they feel really comfortable with certain tasks and have the confidence to perform these tasks, that they can browse and navigate these competencies, that they can identify recommended and required skills related to certain tasks, that comparing of teaching across different content providers is easier. And for data centers, we believe that the sharing of teaching materials will increase, the documentation of the skills that they actually deliver will be easier for them, that they can identify missing teaching activities easier, they can figure out which skills they need to deliver for their core users. And basically, one idea in the future is to correlate the lack of skills with the efficient use. I have something for that here in a second. So in total, wrap up, the HPC Certification Forum is an effort to standardize the representation and the certification of relevant HPC skills. And we are really looking not only in HPC, but generally for the data center and parallel computing. And the goal is not to provide a content or linear curriculum. It's really this puzzle of skills that you can cherry pick for specific tasks. For the data centers, maybe in the long run, what we may see is that You can use statistics and machine learning to direct users to the right skills, because you know when they have certain skills, they have worked more efficiently. And maybe you can make certain skills a mandatory requirement for, let's say, large-scale runs. We also have been working on this customizable representation and navigation for data centers or domains, which is an interactive viewer, which is kind of this JavaScript thing. And we will use this viewer to link good content to the skills too. And yes, please join us on this web page here. So I didn't see any questions so far. If you have any question, I give you 1 minute and then we swap to our next speaker.
Hi, may I ask a question?
Sure.
Hi, I'm Igor Bray. I'm a physicist at Curtin University, Western Australia. I don't quite yet have a feel for how this is going to work. I understand about certification. So, would you be looking to certify existing HPC courses, or are you looking for say our students? So I'm teaching HPC at the moment as an honors unit in honors of physics. Is the idea that our students would take an exam with yourselves to be certified? What's the relationship that you can see between yourselves and say universities?
Yes, a very good question. So, oh, you want to say something, Christian? Was it you? Okay, so then I will
Sorry,
reply.
no, I was muted. I don't think that I interrupted.
Oh, yeah, okay. I thought I heard something. Maybe someone had unmuted the mic. Okay, so the answer is basically you on the university, right? You come up with your curriculum because you say, well, we want to train, I don't know, simulation, right? The software development and the HPC knowledge that you can build large-scale simulation in physics, right? Let's maybe you build your own curriculum. That's totally fine. You do your own exam. That's totally great. What you could do, though, now comes the thing where we come into play, right? Is that you look into the skills that we kind of prescribe here. And you would, for example, say, okay, I will teach something about supercomputers, maybe, right? So into the supercomputer tree, you look into this tree and you find out there are a couple of skills like architectures of supercomputers, for example. And you say, yeah, that, you know, I actually, this learning objectives, there are six learning objectives for this skill. Yeah, I was about to deliver four of them. Maybe I deliver six of them. And if you do this, right, then they would, this your kind of students would have to know to actually go later and do our test, our exam as well, and to obtain this internationally recognized certificate. Okay, so they have your competencies, you know, in the university, your degree, and at the same time they get this internationally recognized kind of certificate that they know these certain skills. That's basically the idea. Is this clarifying the situation, I hope?
Yes, so basically a secondary, so one of the services you will provide is an exam for our students that hopefully after the course that they have been given here, they would be able to take with yourselves to obtain that certification.
Yes, absolutely. That's right. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much.
Yes. And I mean, right, they could even, as part of, as you learn later in the certification process, they could even do it during the course, right? When you delivered, I don't know, one third of the course, maybe you have delivered all the knowledge that they need to fulfill the skills needed in this particular certificate. And then they already do this test, which would also help them, you know, with forward learning the remaining parts of your course, right? So it's not in that sense serve the purpose of supporting learning that much than a mul you know like a quiz that you offer, but it would, you know, give them the confidence, oh, I know this already, I have these certificates, you know, I can do things while your course progresses. Okay, so that's great. So I really